I'm telling you, brother, don't tread on me. Yeah, I'm telling you, brother, don't tread on me.
Hey, everybody, welcome back into the show. Second hour on this hump day Wednesday, November 29th, 2023 edition of Your Defending Fathers with Trucker Randy Bishop here on the Patriot Voice Radio Network. Joining us on the line right now is Ian Murphy from the Iron Pig Smokehouse over in downtown Gaylord. Good morning, sir.
What's up, Trucker Randy?
Well, I apologize for the absence yesterday. I had a funeral to attend, and Izzy Lyman came in and subbed for me. But I wanted to have you on the show today because a lot of things that are happening in Lansing, a lot of this clean energy bills that were just signed into law by Governor Gretchen Whitmer. I wanted to start off in the short segment here, Ian, asking you how much, if you don't mind sharing some private business information, how much money does the Iron Pig spend per month on its utility bills, electric, gas, all of it?
Wow, you know, that's actually a very timely question because I just paid some of them yesterday and I'm looking at some of these fees and everything and I'm like, my goodness. Now, yep. We occupy quite a bit of space in our building. But having said that, our utilities, mainly our gas bill, is one that fluctuates wildly. Our electricity bill here is higher than it should be for a restaurant our size, but that's because of the amount of cold storage that we have built in our basement. But I'll tell you, it's a hard cost that a lot of customers don't really understand the equation of how pricing a burger or how pricing a pulled pork sandwich really works. And when these things fluctuate, forget about labor and food cost. This overhead that we're speaking of, as we call it.
Yep.
That the inability to track that on a regular basis. We've been here for almost 7 years now. So you'd think that we would have a pretty good idea of what we can expect our energy bills to be like. That's just not true. I wish that it were. Now it seems like they're introducing even more questionable. Well, she signed this legislation, but we don't really know what the impact is going to be on our electricity bills and our natural gas bills. When we're talking about, quote, clean energy, unquote, which I believe there is no such thing. When you don't even have nuclear in the equation, the rest of it just becomes a complete farce.
Yes, absolutely. And they pulled in all of the major news stories that I did prepping for the show last night and again this morning. They replaced nuclear power with the words hydropower. And I'm like, wait a minute. You are the guys that have decommissioned and actually have taken down dams all across our state. But now they're replacing nuclear power with hydropower. Only at the very end of that MERS news story, at the very end, did they mention nuclear power and being able to safely store its carbon capture emissions and its spent energy. I'm looking at this and I'm going, you know what? This is an absolute fallacy that they've created in their brain, and they're calling it science based on two studies from companies that I question their scientific capabilities. This is all a bunch of garbage in my mind. I want to get into more of this discussion with you specifically on how you think it's going to impact not only the Iron Pig Smokehouse, but other restaurants and bars and all the places we rely on for public meetings, assemblies, meals, business meetings. I mean, this is potentially going to be huge, and I want to get your perspective on it.
Well, so there's a couple of different ways to look at it, right? So from my point of view, it's what is the end game? What does that end game look like?
Absolutely. We'll talk about it. Ian Murphy is going to stay on through the break with us today. Iron Pig Smokehouse, downtown Gaylord. I'm Trucker Randy. We'll be right back.
Hi, this is Ian Murphy from the Iron Pig Smokehouse in downtown Gaylord. Join me every Tuesday at 10 a.m. with Trucker Randy for an update on all things happening at the Iron Pig. We're open 7 days a week and serving breakfast Saturdays and Sundays. You can order online anytime for takeout, curbside, and delivery at ironpigsmoke.com. And be sure to keep up with our legal battle against the health department by subscribing to our podcast at fuelcasttv.com.
Montana Black Angus beef raised in Onaway, Michigan. Tolini Farms have been raising their cows by feeding them non-GMO corn, barley, wheat, and alfalfa hay, all grown on their own farm. Taking the Ebles for processing, aged, standard cut, vacuum sealed, and frozen, ready for immediate delivery directly to you. Call them today at 989-733-2782 for their current $4 per hanging weight pound. Quarters or halves will feed your family for a year. Call them right now at 989-733-2782.
Presqu'ile Electric and Gas Co-op has been committed to bringing a brighter future to members for more than 85 years. That's why we're hard at work to create a future-focused fiber broadband network that will connect rural Michigan to the world. PIE&G Connect will offer the fastest speeds and most reliable internet available in Northeast Michigan. The future is fiber, powered by Presqu'ile Electric and Gas Co-op. Sign up today at PIEGConnect.com.
Gun owners in northern Michigan don't have to go far to get their firearm problem solved. Curtis Gunsmithing handles all gun work, adjustments, bluing, rebarreling, cleaning, and even FFL transfers. Need a stock refinished or some custom work done? How about a trigger job? That's right. Let the gun doctor, Tom Curtis of Curtis Gunsmithing, take care of old Betsy. She'll be in good hands. Call 231-347-3487. That's 347-3487. Curtis Gunsmithing of Petoskey.
I am Dr. Sherry O'Donnell, running for U.S. Senate. As a missionary physician who's traveled the world, I've seen refugee crisis. Our open borders are causing a national refugee crisis. The failed Biden administration is paying illegal immigrants to enter our country and bring disease, terrorism, trafficking, inflation, and crime. As your next U.S. Senator, I have the international experience to close our borders and secure our homeland. I'm Dr. Sherry O'Donnell and am prepared to close the floodgates. Paid for by Dr. Sherry for Senate.
Hey, everybody, welcome back into the show. Again, staying on through the break is Ian Murphy, the owner of the Iron Pig Smokehouse in downtown Gaylord. Ian, I want you to get into a little bit of the business, the actual numbers, so people can understand, like you say, the cost of a burger or pulled pork sandwich or your brisket platter, which I highly recommend. Ribs, especially. I love the ribs. But let me ask you this question. When you look at not just your labor costs, I'm talking about the people inside the building, but when you're looking at electricity and natural gas, you know, for the smokers, all the things that you do there and have to store the food to be able to prepare it fresh for your customers. And of course, you're looking at your hard costs of your building and all that. I mean, it comes down to a huge amount, percentage of your hard costs is your utility bills. And these new packages of bills that they're signed into law now going into effect, God only knows how that's going to change and affect everything, but it's a huge portion of the percentage of your hard costs that you have to pass on to your customers.
It absolutely is. And again, we're talking about just one segment, right? We're going to set aside the labor dispute that's happening with the fight for 15 and everything else, right? So when we're looking at a menu, regardless if you're going to a big boy or if you're going to, you know, another restaurant here downtown, everybody works on the same formula. Really what it looks like is for every dollar on a menu, right? So if you have something that costs $1, 30 cents goes towards overhead, 30 cents goes towards labor, and then 30 cents goes towards food cost. That 10 cents that's left over or less usually, which is why restaurants have such a high failure rate, is because your profit is within that 10%, that 10 cents, or it's based on pushing those other three categories further down. So what that looks like is, instead of saying 30% food cost, which means you mark something up a number of times in order to get profit out of it, right?
Sure.
So when you take that 30% for food costs and you try and lessen that, that makes that food item more. So a $10 burger now can become $11 or $10.50 or $11.50. When you try and that simple equation of 30%, 30%, 30% is standard across the industry. That is the general formula. Now, what's happening, especially in the last 3 years, because of mainly the pandemic, labor has exploded, food cost has exploded because of supply chain issues. Now, we're talking about growing this other category, our overhead. So overhead, labor, and food costs. The other two categories have been growing exponentially over the years, regardless. Now, even more so since the pandemic. So it's this ongoing equation where now what I see happening is restaurants are starting to go more towards 25% or even 20% in order to, because people have to understand the prices that we set now are for the future. We don't get to go back and get extra money for what we've already sold. So we have to sort of predict what the future has in store for us. We used to do this on a quarterly basis, but since the pandemic, some of us learned to do this on a monthly basis. Part of the reason why our menus are printed on paper. So a lot of consumers don't really understand that that's how the equation gets set up. Now, when you see McDonald's raising the price of a Big Mac, it's because they're having to pay more in labor, they're having to pay more in food costs, or they're having to pay more in overhead. Usually not overhead, because they're the biggest real estate owners on the planet.
Sure.
But so many people can simply jump to the argument, well, they want to make more profit. While I'm sure that's the case with McDonald's because they have shareholders and a fiduciary responsibility there,
yep.
Small business owners like myself, we're in it for survival. If anything in the last 3 years has taught us anything, the sunshiniest days can be great, but we've got to pack it away for days that are coming that we're just not sure exactly what's going to happen. You know, we've seen a 20% increase in labor. In my opinion, that needed to happen. It's just unfortunate the way that it came about. But moving forward with these energy policies that we're talking about,
exactly,
that the governor just signed, I'll take that one step further. I use cherry wood in my smoker that gets exhausted four stories above us on Main Street. I know they're going to be coming for me burning wood in a smoker. There are studies that are already coming out that are saying how harmful it is to be burning wood of any kind anywhere. So I'm seeing this coming down the pipe where they're going to say certain types of fuel are going to be limited, aka natural gas. Then it's going to get to a point where they will say you can no longer burn wood in a place of commercial business.
Yeah.
Then they'll probably end up taking it to a point where you can't burn campfire wood or something silly like that. Sounds ridiculous, but remember, we were making jokes about banning the gas stove.
And here we are. And here's the other component to that. They may say first, not a total ban on burning your cherry wood for your smoker, but if you install a very expensive carbon capture and can capture and contain. That's actually in one of the stories I read earlier. They want people to capture and contain carbon dioxide.
Yeah, I agree with that 100%. And that's a false narrative as well. They're proving carbon capture is a complete joke for offsetting carbon footprints, which is also a complete joke. I see them regulating the output of my carbon footprint, issuing not necessarily fines, but a permitting system based on the level of carbon that I'm putting out.
Yes.
And then that will fund the idea of this carbon capture equipment that then I will then be required to pay X amount of dollars for X amount of CFM or however the heck they.
Yes. Unbelievable. And the other component, and again, it goes back to a simple, you know, ninth grade biology, photosynthesis, and they don't even want to talk about that. And it's like, wait a minute, God created this really cool system of carbon dioxide being absorbed by vegetation, trees, plants, bushes, and producing oxygen. If we capture all the carbon dioxide, what's that going to do to the vegetation?
Right, exactly. You're taking a so-called poison from one spot and putting it into another area. I mean, that's really all that we're doing.
Absolutely. One thing I did want to talk to you about too is staying open through the winter. A lot of local businesses, you know, shut down in the wintertime, but your restaurant is actually a place that people have grown accustomed to being able to go and have business meetings and lunches and different meetings of all kinds that you do there. Breakfast now, carry out, the whole nine yards. But so many of these other smaller mom-pa operations that are not as technically up to date as you are on your operation, a lot of them are telling me they're shutting down for the winter. This is going to impact our economy.
Yeah, you know, I'm hearing that this last Black Friday wasn't the greatest. Small Business Saturday wasn't the greatest. You know, it wasn't a banner year for us. Is, you know, one of our best indicators is our gift card sale, which is still going on, ironpigsmoke.com. Pick them up, $30 gift card for $19.
Yeah.
Shameless plug. I understand that. Part of me sort of wishes I could do that. That may be a luxury for some people, but I don't think that's the folks that you're referring to. You know, I'm beginning to understand, you know, the restaurants that do a 5-day work week where they're closed for 2 days. Unfortunately for a smokehouse, there really are no days off for us. You know, if we take 2 days off, we still have people that would be in the restaurant, you know, smoking food for the day before, because we smoke anywhere from 12 to 18 hours, some of our proteins.
Sure.
So that, you know, from Jump Street, I've always said, you know, let's just be open 7 days. That does create a little bit of a different staffing plan than a 5-day restaurant. But yeah, we're open 7 days a week. I hope that doesn't change. You know, we've got plenty of snow over here in Gaylord. Treetops Resort is opening up tomorrow and for the weekend. So that's what we need as a tourist community, is, you know, the downstate folks that are listening to your program right now, come on up. We have snow. Bring the side-by-sides. Bring the sleds. Come up skiing.
Yep.
They're the ones that keep us small mom and pops going, usually through October through March. That's, you know, we always know that we'll get the traffic in the summertime. Northern Michigan is so gorgeous in the summertime, but there are significantly fewer folks that you know, can afford to go snowmobiling and side-by-siding and skiing as well.
Yeah, absolutely. I want to get into FOIA requests, Freedom of Information Act. You have been submitting these. What the heck's going on that front?
Yeah, so I've been wanting to do this for a while and kind of hadn't had the time. So I submitted a FOIA request asking the Michigan Department of Health and Human Services for any information about their COVID violation hotline that has been out since March of 2020. And I believe it's still active. I'm seeking any and all information from complaints that they had received about the Iron Pig. Right. So this would be somebody coming into the restaurant, not seeing a mask and calling the hotline, or somebody driving by and seeing the open sign on after 11 o'clock or something, something that could have been a violation. Somebody that saw, you know, an article on the media somewhere most likely called and complained. So first they asked for an extension. I just received word Monday. I think what day it was Monday. They denied my request, actually stating that they have no information regarding the Iron Pig and that hotline. I believe that to be false, so we're most likely going to appeal that decision.
Now, that is an interesting point, because if in fact they denied your request, claiming there's no such data, they're basically admitting that they had no complaints against the Iron Pig. Is that what they're basically trying to say?
I would have to assume that one can logically draw that conclusion. That is one conclusion that I think could be drawn from this. The other option is that I may resubmit, because I did this on my own, did it without an attorney. I may resubmit and narrow the focus of that request, which I thought it was pretty narrow to begin with. But I'm going to appeal that one and file a new one as well. So
right.
This is supposed to be the government of transparency. You know, we passed a proposition last year, whenever it was, for more transparency in government. They still haven't done it. They boasted about all this other nonsense that they passed, but yet they can't get the transparency issue all the way through to have the governor signed. And I mean, we all know why, let's be honest. But here we just see more of the hypocrisy of the leadership that we have in Lansing.
Absolutely. Well, one thing that I am definitely always excited in asking people to participate is gift cards as presents, because it makes it so simple, especially the way you've done it. Explain again to the folks how they can get these discounted gift cards valued at $30 for a less amount of money. Give them out to friends, coworkers, friends, family, people at the church, a pastor or whoever. How can they do it to get them to come down to the Iron Pig?
So they're on sale, ironpigsmoke.com. What it is you receive a $30 gift card. And we've used another small business right here out of Gaylord called Priceline. They're a software company that it's crowdsourcing the price of something. We've used this for our tickets before. We use this for our NFT. The more of something that gets purchased, the cheaper it gets. So we started at $30. That gift card, we sold so many of them that price for a $30 gift card dropped all the way down to, I think, $19.90. So we've frozen a $30 gift card only costs $19.90. Now, we email that to you right away so you get that. So you can print that, put it in a stocking stuffer, or you can email it to a friend. If you're not going to see them for Christmas, you can just email it to a colleague, email it to a family member, something like that. It's super easy. It's the digital age. It's the easiest way to do it. Ironpigsmoke.com, a $30 gift card only costs you $19.90.
Beautiful. Absolutely. Greatly appreciated. And I highly recommend the brisket platter or the ribs. Man, we got those a couple Fridays ago, and we always want to eat out on Fridays. And I was in Gaylord and just happened to stop in and got to see you there.
Yeah, that was great timing, bud. And appreciate you as always.
All right, man. Have a great day. We'll talk to you next Tuesday.
You got it.
All right, brother. Bottom of the hour news break. We'll be right back.